Hey everyone, it's the EOS, and let's check into the T1 versus Freddy Debrion series, which happened yesterday. I did saw the series, but not paid full attention, so it's basically I'm reviewing the game right now from the beginning. And let's check the games one's draft. So let's start with T1. They obviously had priority in the Senna, Tahm, Kench bottom lane, but as I'm saying always, when teams want to play this bot lane duo, they need to play around this duo. They need to give them priority. Most of the times, this bottom duo wins most of the matches in the bottom lane, but they need attention. They also have some engage tool in Volibear, but of course engaging by himself is not so useful. Then they picked a disengage tool in Azir, so basically they have an engage champion in Volibear and then a disengage champion in Azir. Obviously Faker's Azir is one of his main champions, and of course he can use his ultimate to also engage. But, and maybe this is a smart decision, because on the other hand, Freddy Debrion picked the common Nocturne and Rumble duo. I'm really surprised that they didn't pick Leona. I mean, Leona was banned in the second ban phase, but I'm curious if they could pick her at this point of the first pick phase, because T1 have already picked the AD carry, so they have already banned these three champions, meaning that they only had two picks. And if Freddy Debrion picked Leona at this point, then they would have picked probably an AD carry, but you know, with Leona you have other options as well. You have Kai'Sa, you have Tristana. I mean, it's obvious that Freddy Debrion's comp is about engaging. All of their champs are engaged champions except the Thresh. But the Thresh was picked because Leona was not available, right? And Nautilus was the other alternative pick on Leona. But basically, this comp right here, basically T1 picked this comp in their first series against Hanwha last week, and they made the wombo combo with Nocturne, Rumble, and Leona's ultimates. So that's why I'm insisting that Freddy Debrion should pick Leona right here. And let's say that T1 would ban Varus in the second draft phase, they could easily pick Kai'Sa or Tristana, which matches very well with Leona. And of course, they want to play a full engage comp, so Kai'Sa and Tristana would be much better here. And for last pick, they went with Diana. I'm not sure if they had other options here, because obviously by picking Diana, it means that Rumble is going to the top lane. So maybe let's think, what are other junglers that... Well, first of all, They should have picked an ability power jungler, which they did. I'm not sure if Echo here would be a good option, but yeah, this is not the end of the world. But anyway, like I said, this is an engaged comp, but Thresh is kind of front and back, so support, he's not a full engage support, and he doesn't have the strong CC like Leona in order to lock the enemy team into Rumble's ultimate and then for Nocturne to follow up. So I would say that T1 have a better draft for game one, and let's jump into the game. Okay, I remember this point because I was watching the live stream from Kaedral's channel, and he made a really good observation here. Look at Diana's pathing. Diana started blue, and then she went into her red buff and golems. This is a very unusual and unorthodox jungle pathing, and the only thing that Kaedral could think about was that maybe she did that because Diana wants to move into the bottom scuttle and contest it, and by doing this unorthodox pathing, it will allow her to keep her red buff longer, while maybe Volibear, by making a more logical, let's say, jungle pathing, he wouldn't have one of his two buffs. So that's the only way that Kaedrel said that he could think about this Diana's pathing. Unfortunately, this scenario never happened, so at the end of the day, it was a failed attempt, let's say, to make this path. It was very unorthodox, because as you can see now, Diana is contesting Scuttle by herself, so there's no Volibear there, and now she needs to go back and clear her bottom side, her blue side jungle. Also, by making this path, it makes her response, you know, the second rotation basically of her jungle camps, it makes it also awkward and unorthodox, because now she cannot make, you know, junglers should always move like a train, right? So they should have a logical pathing in their jungle, meaning that if the second rotation in jungle starts here in golems, then wraith should be available, and then you should move to wolves, gromp, and possibly try to make a gank in the bottom lane or in the mid lane, or play for a dragon. And the same way goes for the other side. So if Diana started her full, if Diana cleared her blue side jungle faster, then she could go to gromp for second rotation. I mean, she could go to gromp, wolves, raptors and golems, and again make a play in the top lane. But this unusual pathing now creates different response in her jungle camps. So now you see how much time Umti is losing here. Basically, he's waiting for his second rotation in golems, and he had to wait in the brass without making any moves. And this is a meta, and now his golems were warded from Kana. And this is a meta where junglers need to be very proactive and move very fast, clear their jungle caps fast, and also move around the map fast. And that's why now Volibear has this opportunity here to check Diana's camps. So now Diana decided to start the first dragon of the game, because look at her jungle. Umti doesn't have any options to farm anything in his jungle, so he's basically forced to make this to start the first dragon. But his bottom lane don't have priority, so yeah, this is like a very risky play. But at least Lava has lane priority in the mid lane, so apparently they could make this play. And this is a very nice counterplay to Volibear's gank, because as you can see, first of all, Lava is playing really well in this first series of Reddit Brion so far in the season. So basically, he started his paranoia to block Volibear's and Lucian's vision, and he's teleporting, and of course they both understand how this play, what's the logic behind this play. So we have a nice first blood for Fredded Brion due to Lava's outplay. Really nice play, really smart. And now Diana can finally start her second jungle rotation. So here is again. So first he started with paranoia and then he TP'd. But of course, T1 players are experienced and they understood this play. But of course, they couldn't defend against it other than running away. And now Volibear is stealing Diana's camps just because what I explained earlier. So let's see here. I don't remember what happened here. Diana couldn't stop golems. And this is again really nice zoom out here from the spectators, by the way. This is something that most of the teams do. And unfortunately, we have seen some glimpses. Many analysts have talked about How important is for the AD carry players to stay in the bottom lane when the rest of the teams are contesting the first Herald? Because, like we said before, Herald Crash gives two turret plates. If you leave your bottom, if you leave your AD carry in the bottom lane to farm, first your AD carry takes almost two waves worth of experience for himself, and also two turret plates also for himself. So it's much more worth to not contest the first Herald, leave your AD carry in the bottom lane to take priority and to take some gold for itself, instead of just, you know, coin flipping the first Herald fight so early in the game. And also, I also forgot to mention that up until level 6, T1's comp is much stronger in the lanes, during the lane phases. Or sorry, the other way around. Frenzied Brion's comp is stronger in the early phase until T1's players reach level 6. So it's very risky to contest this Herald. I'm gonna put it in normal speed. So yeah, they're forcing Herald, and even though they left in the series against Hanwha, they left Ted in the bottom lane to do what I said earlier, apparently here they decided to just have him there. But on the other hand, let's not forget that Senna is a hybrid AD carry, so let's see the fight here. Full engages. And of course, Frenzied Brion's comp is a full engage comp, so they obviously have an advantage here until T1 players reach level 6. But what I wanted to mention earlier is that one of the disadvantages of Senna is that it's a hybrid AD carry, and she doesn't have a strong push in order to stay in the bottom lane and contest two turret plates for herself. So Teddy had to be grouped with the rest of his team, but obviously they lose to this comp. And now Kaz took advantage of Frenzied Brion's reset, so now he took the Herald as he wanted. But we have another fight here. So now T1 reached level 6, all of their players, and they found Umti doing something into their Raptors. I don't know what he was doing there with no vision, because I don't see any... If you see T1's red side jungle, I don't see any red wards from Frenzied Brion, so I don't know what Umti was trying to do there. Maybe he was trying to steal Volibear's camps due to Volibear killing Herald, but it's not worth, because his teammates didn't have any priority. Yeah, this fight doesn't matter, we saw that. I mean, we knew that Frenzied Brion would win this team fight. And now let's see. Okay, so Umti's bottom lane, or first of all, T1's bottom lane hasn't shown in the map yet, meaning that it's too dangerous to do that. Actually, they're in mid lane. What am I saying here? Sorry. Yeah, they're in mid lane, but they have priority. And Varus is trying to push the wave back to T1's turret. So Frenzied Brion don't have any priority in the mid and in the bottom lane. And for some reason here, Umti decided to just go and steal Volibear's Raptors. And yeah, he actually thought that he would be the one to set a trap to T1's players. But now all players of T1 are level 6, and apparently they were able to kill him, of course. Second Drake, really important for Frenzied Brion, because they also get outscaled. They also get outscaled in the later stages of the game, so having an Infernal Dragon might be helpful with Rumble's ultimate, with Varus pokes. So if they can contest Infernal Drake's ult, this would help them. And basically, Frenzied Brion are putting their eggs into Varus' basket, so they're trying to get him ahead, but I don't see any ganks or any plays in the bottom lane. He just keeps a CS lead, but other than that, T1s are the ones that make the moves and the plays here. And of course, Rumble in top lane, which is the most top lane is the most is usually the weak side because it's the furthest lane compared to the rest of the lanes, and having Rumble there by himself, basically he's exposed to ganks such like Volibear's ganks. And usually, like, look at Umti right here. This is a really bad game overall for Umti because, like I said, they having some difficulties in their top lane, and he doesn't try to make plays in the bottom lane to put Varus further ahead in the game. Senna and Tahmkent will outscale them, and they will have more sustain and heal, so they really need to make a play in the bottom lane, but they didn't. And now T1 took the tier 1 top turret, and this is the gank again. Pretty simple, no support from anyone in his team, and no counterplays in the bottom lane of T1s. So now we see the rotations already. Faker is moving in the top side because he can escape much better. Lucian as an AD carry player moves into the mid lane, and of course Senna can be with him, can be grouped with him because it's a fasting Senna. And Tahmkent being tanky can stay in the bottom lane and can farm safely. I mean, Fredded Brion, Varus and Thresh don't even try to freeze the wave in order to deny Tahmkent some farming. So Tahmkent can just wait for the wave to crash into his turret and farm safely. And at the same time, just because T1 have top priority and mid priority, they have already destroyed tier 1 top turret. So now they can more easily and much more safely rotate into the second Herald, which will make them crash more turrets and have more map pushing, map pressure. And if you set the gold, I mean, they are already almost 4k gold ahead, you know, just by these rotations, just by taking all these turrets, and just by having CS lead in almost all of their lanes. The only lane that they don't have any CS lead is the bottom lane, but like I said, Fredded Brion didn't make anything about it. And this is the typical situation where teams have to decide whether they should group into the mid turret to defend it against Herald's charge, or gather around a Dragon in order to have Dragon pit control and try to contest Dragon, because it's really important. Like I said, this is a turret with no plates, so it's not like T1 are gonna take a lot of gold from this turret. But on the other hand, Fredded Brion need to take the third Dragon, because like I said, they need Infernal Soul in order to have a chance to come back into this game. But of course they also didn't make any rotations around it when they should. So here Lucian was saved from Tahmkent, and they managed to also pick a kill, but Volibear died. I didn't see how. I'm gonna put the replay of this team fight in normal speed to see how Volibear died. Yeah, let's see it in a normal speed. Ulti from Volibear, ulti from Lucian, Equalizer, Tahmkent saves Lucian. Teddy was actually very far behind, so that's why he had to flash to pick up a kill. And I'm also very surprised that T1 didn't kill the Dragon afterwards, because they didn't want to get greedy. So they resetted, and now they are back. And now they can push two waves. The really nice ult from Faker here. Faker got the MVP for both games. I don't remember what he picked in the second game, but definitely these type of engages definitely deserve an MVP award. Because like I said, Azir is not just a disengaged champion. He can also do engage plays like this. And they didn't have a vision on him, so he also had to flash. but he was sure that he could make this play work. Yeah, you see? He's sitting on a control ward, so Fredebjorn couldn't know that he was there. And with his flash and ult, he managed to kill Varus and Thresh. Or just Varus, if I'm not mistaken. I think they only killed Varus. Very early Baron here for T1. I'm not sure if this is a correct play, but they bursted very good. Rumble is too far away, so I want to go back. Okay, so apparently they saw Rumble was in the bottom lane, and probably they know that Rumble's TP is down. So yeah, maybe this is a good play after all. I mean, they're so much ahead in the game right now, so they can burst. They have two ADs and also Azir's soldiers, so they can burst Baron really well. But yeah, they stopped this play. Rumble was far away still, but yeah, it was a risky play, so that's good for them that they stopped it. And another thing is that Varus needs some time in order to build his core lethality items, because champions that need to build mana immune, it's basically an extra item, and if your team is behind, then they have to give you all the resources to for you to farm and to build your items, and that takes time. So while Varus is trying to build his core lethality items and be relevant in the game and make, you know, a decent amount of damage, T1 are making their moves around the map. They have constant map pressure, they have lane priorities, and they can contest now the objectives. And as I said earlier, they also outscale Fredebjorn, so the longer the game goes, the better for T1, obviously. So it's really difficult for Fredebjorn to get back into this game, because they never helped Varus get ahead in the game. He was the only laner which had some priority, and he was winning lane, basically. Okay, so we have 10 seconds for next dragon. Probably this will go uncontested. I'm gonna put it in normal speed. So Nocturne has TP. He just used it in the mid lane. Let's see how this fight goes. Basically, I think that we're going to see the first 5v5 team fight and see how Fredebjorn will play their wombo combo. But without an engage support with stuns like Leona or Nautilus at least, it's more difficult for them to execute it properly. And Tahmkent with Volibear are already tanky enough, I think, to sustain Fredebjorn's damage. So they started Dragon. They pulled it towards their side, and that's really a smart play. Apparently they will get it. Yeah, they got it. They got it, and both teams disengage. Okay. At least that was something. But you see how T1 played this really carefully. They didn't burn anything. On the other hand, Fredebjorn burned Rumble's ultimate in order to zone T1 out of Dragon, so now they don't have the equalizer to make their wombo combo. But still, T1 are playing this very carefully, as Nocturne takes tier 1 mid turret. So yeah, kudos to Fredebjorn, they just got their first turret in the game. But of course, if you want to have map pressure, you always need to first prioritize getting the side lane turrets and not the mid one, because it's very easy to defend mid lane and to push the wave back. So yeah, that didn't do much to them. Okay, let's see the rotate. I'm not sure why they're not sending anyone in the top lane. Probably they want to make a play here, but I mean, we have 3 minutes for the next dragon, so I think that they should send someone in the top lane to push the top lane. Lucian should be in the bottom lane or top. Okay, now they send Azir finally. Nice. So they regain the lane priority in all three lanes. And of course, now things become more difficult for FredBjorn. Basically, the only way for them to get back into the game is if they have the perfect team fight in the next dragon, because of course both teams want to contest the next dragon. FredBjorn want to contest it because it will be Infernal Soul, and it's their only chance to get back into the game. And of course T1 want to deny this from them, because they also know that the only win condition right now for FredBjorn to get back into the game is this Infernal Soul. And if they play the next two or three team fights perfectly with Infernal Soul, that's their only way to get back into the game. But look at the control wards from T1, Faker TP'd, and when you have to push all these lanes, you don't have time to get control in Dragon Pit, but we have a fight here before Dragon respond, so let's see what happened. I'm surprised that T1 are actually forcing this fight in this open space. Okay, nice stopwatch from Faker. Yeah, good luck bursting down Tahmkent and Volibear. Yeah, in a way it was kind of worth, because they forced FredBjorn to burn their ultimates, and now they managed to got Dragon and deny them the Infernal Soul. Yeah, actually it was a really smart play from T1, because they forced this team fight. Actually, they were mostly baiting FredBjorn into this team fight, because obviously T1 don't have an engaged comp. So they baited FredBjorn into this team fight in an open space for them to burn their ultimates, and in order for them to not have their wombo combo in the dragon fight. And then even if FredBjorn were just in the inside the dragon pit, basically they couldn't contest this dragon, and they lost their opportunity to get Infernal Drake Soul. And now again, T1 can bait them into the Baron. They can again dance around them in order to make them burn their abilities, and then engage themselves. I mean, yeah, that wombo combo didn't work from Rumble and Nocturne, because like I said, they don't have a third CC champion, like for example Leona, in order to follow up. So basically what happened was Nocturne ulted into, I think, Teddy or Faker, and then he had to move back because Faker ulted him away. And yeah, Rumble just threw his equalizer, but T1 have enough sustain to to survive from this damage. I hope we can get a replay. Yeah, I think that basically this was the last team fight that FredBjorn had anything to try. So look at here. So usually what happens is Nocturne opens up with his ultimate. Then, because everything is in dark mode, Leona follows up with her ultimate, and then Rumble follows up with his equalizer. But they don't have Leona, so now only Nocturne can go in. But look at the kiting from T1. So even, I mean, he ulted Faker, but Faker has Zhonya's, and he also has Senna behind him to heal him all the time. So now Nocturne had to fall back to avoid Faker's ultimate. But at the same time, a tanky Volibear just engaged into the rest of FredBjorn's team. And yeah, they barely managed to get him into 50% of his HP, but he has massive regeneration. Yep. Okay. A satisfied T1 fan. So yeah, basically I would say that the game is over at this point, because FredBjorn will never get the opportunity to contest the fourth Drake. And again, you see, even if they try to make this play, you're making this play to Varus. To Lucian, which, by the way, has a Guardian Angel. So what are you going to get out of this? Nothing, exactly. I mean, they're getting more bursted themselves instead of trying to make a pick. But yeah, basically the game ended for Ferdit Brion when they didn't give any lead to Varus. They didn't make any plays to bottom lane when I think Kaz was able to gank Rumble two or three times. And they killed him. They killed him two times. And then Diana... I mean, Umti lost a game, I think, for Ferdit Brion because his first jungle rotation was awful. And his second one was even worse. And then he invaded T1's Raptors for no reason. And he got caught and killed. And after that, nobody was available from Ferdit Brion to help Varus and give him and get him ahead into the game. And then T1 just won the game with pure macro. Yeah, there's no way that Ferdit Brion can execute their comp. And if you remember earlier when I analyzed the draft, I think that they should get Leona in R3. And even if T1 banned Varus, they could get Kai'Sa or Tristana. Yeah, there's no point putting this into normal speed. It's clear that Ferdit Brion won't have any major plays. They can't have any major plays. And we are at the 38th minute of the game. So obviously, even in the best case scenario, even if they execute everything perfect in a teamfight, they can't kill T1 at this point because they got outscaled. So, yeah, I mean, I think the game ended in a couple of minutes, so I'm just gonna keep the video going until the official end. I'm a bit biased towards T1, so I want to basically analyze their full games, not just show highlights. But yeah, you see. Actually, this was kind of the best teamfight that Ferdit Brion got, but still, like I said, they get outscaled so much. Yeah, you see? They hit their full comp, Nocturne's ultimate, followed by Equalizer, followed by Diana's engage. And actually, Diana got three or four people from T1. But yeah, they are so outscaled that basically they couldn't win this fight. Oh, okay. Nice recall stop here from Keria. And GG, game one, won from T1.